We have, of course, reached the 1 year anniversary of the absolutely horrifying October 7th, 2023 terror attacks. And we hit that anniversary as we leave, we exit a weekend that shows just how chaotic and devastating and horrifying and unimaginable everything about all of this has been for the last year. Over the weekend, Israeli forces bombed a mosque and a school turned shelter in Gaza, killing 26 and injuring dozens more. The Israeli military described the two sites as Hamas quote, command and control centers, but provided no evidence. Maybe they are, maybe they're not. It's always the claim. The Israeli military also on Sunday announced a new phase of the war in Gaza, issuing new evacuation orders that cover most of the north. Meanwhile, just most of the north, the like half of the entire region. Meanwhile, Israel conducted the most severe airstrikes so far in Beirut, pounding the city overnight. According to the Lebanese health ministry, 23 people were killed, 93 injured on Saturday. And of course, there has been a lot of death since October 7th of last year. On that day, over 1,200 Israelis were killed, over 250 were taken hostage. And ever since then, of course, there's been no holds barred in any way, no war crimes respected, and over 41,000 people have died in Gaza. Over 101 of the hostages are still believed to be in Gaza, seven of them being Americans and numerous other foreign nationals. And bear in mind, when we throw out the 41,000 number, the estimates, this is the Israeli estimates, is that 17 to 18,000 Hamas fighters have been killed. I read that, I'm a non-expert, as a male between the age of 16 and 70, but they're being listed as Hamas fighters, and it's possible that many or maybe all are, suggesting around 60% of those who have died are civilians. And I don't know, again, not an expert, I don't know exactly what percentage civilian casualties is considered acceptable historically around the globe. I'm hoping that it's less than 60. I don't think it should be 60. I think that's unacceptable. Call me overly bold, I don't know. By the way, in just the short period of time that the Lebanese, the invasion of Lebanon has happened, over 2,000 people have died there, including at least 127 children. And aside from the death toll on the Israeli side, the Gazan side, in Lebanon, and perhaps in Iran soon too, at least half of all of the homes in the Gaza Strip are damaged or destroyed, 80% of commercial facilities, 85% of school buildings. And in May, a UN agency estimated that there were likely 10,000 Palestinian dead trapped under the rubble of these many buildings, and that it might take as long as 3 years to recover all of the bodies if they're ever recovered. And I think, hey, silver lining, there's a good chance that many will be, because the rubble of those buildings will need to be cleared away for whatever ends up getting developed in Gaza in the future. But obviously, this is one of the worst situations of our life, of living memory. And I know, Francesca, you have a lot of thoughts about it.
I mean, yeah, I think that if you had told me a year ago that we were going to still be here without a ceasefire, with the body count rising, with the death toll rising, and an expanded war on Lebanon, even me, who has known about Israeli occupation and the many, many wars on the people of Gaza over the decades, I probably wouldn't have believed you that we would be here. I probably would have thought something, someone, I don't know, global superpower with the biggest military and the biggest military budget on earth might have done something at this point to stand up for human rights and to end the bloodshed. That has not happened. And I think the biggest thing over the last year really isn't the way that the Israeli government has acted. The Israeli government has wanted to do what it has done, and October 7th was a pretext for it. Sad for the hostages that still remain allegedly under Hamas guardianship or whatever, in Hamas hands. But but truly, this is just something that we all knew that Israel was going to do, that it was going to be outsized, the response. We just didn't know how much. And the fact that they are now using it as a pretext to reconquest all of Gaza, but in addition, start a war with Lebanon, and in fact, try to who knows, recolonize southern Lebanon, and on and on and on. The biggest thing and the biggest thing that we've learned in the last year is the United States has absolutely abdicated its role when it comes to trying to rein in our allies, right? John, like this to me is the biggest failure. And in the last couple of weeks, it's only gotten more acute and clear that the Biden administration has never been serious about ceasefire. Remember how they told us in the first months of this genocide that we shouldn't say ceasefire, that that was, even Anthony Blinken, Secretary of State, put out a statement, then he immediately retracted it. Well, then they changed their tune. They were like, okay, we'll get on board with the ceasefire and we're working around the clock. Well, ceasefire has always meant to the Americans what it has meant to the Israelis, which is a full and total obliteration of all of so-called Hamas, which we know they do not distinguish between Hamas and, as you mentioned earlier, civilians. They literally don't. In fact, their AI murder systems have been designed to maximize casualties, in fact, not minimize them. So it does not matter. That's why you bomb hospitals. That's why you bomb schools where people are sheltering. That's why you try to kill babies who were in incubators in Al-Shifa Hospital and other hospitals. That's why you allow them to decompose in their incubators instead of attend to them, because you are trying to ethnically cleanse an entire people. So it's just, the game is up with the United States. I mean, we need to keep the pressure on, John, but I am just like, last week it really sealed the deal as this war expanded into Lebanon, that Biden is not just weak and impotent, but he is complicit and on board with genocide, that it's all okay, no matter what Israel does. And it's disgusting. It is his legacy.
Yeah, look, I know a lot of people will say of either Biden or Harris that they don't care or they don't mind. I think that's too far, but they won't do what they can do to stop it. I think that's fair. I think you could stop it from happening. Or you could, by the way, I might, like, let's say you were to ask me, okay, what could Biden do? What's the most pressure he could use? And I could give you all of my non-expert arguments for what he could do. And that could fail. He could do everything that I ask, and it could not change Netanyahu's strategy. But you know what would still be different? We would have done everything we could to stop it from happening, and that would be better. On some moral level, that would be better. And we have not done that. And we're gonna play a video clip for you just a little bit that shows that we're not going to do that. That's just not a thing that's going to happen. But I agree with you about the sort of like the feeling sort of like sinking in. I don't know, last week definitely part of it, just gradually. Like, if you had told me a year ago, over 40,000, let's say over 20,000 civilians, around 20,000 women and children would die. And some people would care, but not nearly enough. And way more people would spend a significant portion of the time. It basically become their new hobby over the last year, where they justify the killing of civilians, including children. And that's just a thing they do constantly. I would say that doesn't seem likely. And that is because I'm still naive and stupid. After all my time following the news, I still think, well, X surely will get through to people. Yeah. You know, I mean, if like dozens of kids are slaughtered in a school, we'll do something about guns, obviously. I mean, if this many kids die, something. No. You can justify almost anything.
Yes.
There are a lot of people who have allowed themselves, they have eagerly been propagandized to.
Yes.
And they will take any like paper thin facade of an intellectual or moral argument for why absolute evil is not only acceptable, but honestly, why are we even talking about it? And it makes me sick on a daily basis. By the way, just last week, 100 people in Gaza were killed by Israeli airstrikes and ground operations. Is it slower than in the beginning? A little, I guess. But 100 people died. just last week.
And I just want to really quickly before we move on, I'm glad we're having this conversation, but it's really important to know that the 41,000 number has been stuck at that for what? What are we now, like 4 or 5 months? Which and the question is why? Everyone needs to remember that the reason is that the number of casualties in Gaza that have been reported are stuck there is because the people who would report them are dead, have been detained, have been disappeared, that there is no media allowed into Gaza anymore, that the Gazan health ministry is running on nothing. I believe there was for a couple months, no hospitals in Gaza. Now I believe there is one hospital, and that the Gaza health ministry, if they cannot fully identify the person, they won't log that. Meaning if there's a limb, which when you drop 2,000 pound bombs on a refugee camp, yes, people turn to dust. Those numbers are not counted. So there, the Lancet reported months ago that the total number dead could be almost 200,000. You need to understand that. Now, that is a guess based on what we haven't heard reported. But that is what they were saying. We still don't know because we don't know when we're gonna get out of, as Israel says, the fog of war.
Members make a difference here at TYT. You help make the show happen, and we see you in the chat with your loyalty badge. Click the join button to become a member today.